Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome all of you to the kickoff event for the Great War, Great Read series. My name is Linda Trout, and I'm the Director of Strategic Engagement here at the museum. And with me today is Crosby Kemper, who's the Executive Director of the Kansas City Public Library. We're really excited about this program, which has been many months in the planning, a collaboration between the library and the museum. We're going to be featuring two books during this period, All Quiet on the Western Front and The Guns of August. And we're going to use those as a stepping stone for some contemporary works and things that are going on. I want to tell you just a minute about our museum. The National World War I Museum here was designated by the United States Congress as the country's official World War I museum. As such, we are a center for activities commemorating the centennial of the Great War, World War I, and we have a lot of activities both in the Great War, Great Read program, and other activities going on. So I hope that you'll take time to see our exhibits and to see some of the programming that we have going on and come back and visit often. As you know, the war began 100 years ago in 1914. The museum began its commemoration on June 28th, the date that the Austria-Hungarian Archduke Franz Ferdinand was assassinated in Sarajevo. If, for a moment, you were to imagine that this is 1914 rather than 2014, then Austria-Hungary declared war on Serbia last Monday. On Friday, Germany declared war on Russia, and today, Germany declared war on France. Tomorrow, Britain declares war on Germany. Germany invades Belgium, and warfare begins. We can hear the guns of August as we think about that. Crosby, how would you describe the enduring significance of the Great War?
Well, of course, it was the war that made the world safe for democracy. It was the war to end all wars. What they thought they did, or were in the process of doing, of course, is very different from what actually happened. But the importance, I think, of World War I is there are a number of things that need to be recognized. One, it was not the first completely, but it was certainly the largest and maybe established for the 20th century and beyond. It was a war both of nations, not of monarchies, not of states, but of nations and of peoples. The rise of nationalism in the 19th century and the increasing democratization in the 19th century, what Tocqueville was writing about, made this a war that was not completely different. It had predecessors in terms of the Civil War, in terms of the wars of the French Revolution, levée en masse. But it was larger and deeper in both those areas than anything previously. And it was truly a world war. One could say the Seven Years' War was a world war in some ways, and the Napoleonic Wars in some ways were a world war. But truly, World War I is the first war that was fought in all parts of the globe. And as a war of peoples, it's the first war, at least the first war in modern history. One goes back to the immediate pre-modern era, maybe even the early modern era, there are examples of this, but it was a war that included everybody. It was a war of people, so it included all the civilian population in terms of both support and supply for the war, but also ultimately is what we sometimes hear today called collateral damage, but wasn't so collateral. Much of it was deliberate, as we now know about the German atrocities and as the war at the level of the trenches is described by historians increasingly. So Steven Pinker's written a book recently, The Better Angels of Our Nature, in which he makes the claim that modern history sees a diminution of violence, a steady diminution of violence. And if you look at the very broad sweep of history, that's probably true. But if we look back at World War I, and then some of the things that have happened as a result of World War I, like World War II, the Holocaust, the rise of communism, and what happened in the Soviet Union, in Mao's China, Pol Pot's Cambodia, et cetera. Maybe we think that the legacy of World War I is very different from that. And finally, I think the shape of the world today, the Middle East, which we're engaged in reading the front pages and trying to sort things out, and affects the United States, us, and Iraq, and Israel, et cetera. All that was created as a result of World War I. Winston Churchill and many others drew the map of the Middle East, which we're still trying to understand, still trying to quiet down. And the rise of China and the rise of Japan are intimately related to the results of World War I. The entire world of the 20th century, the fight of totalitarianism versus democracy, is also a result of World War I. So it's probably more important for the shape of our world today than World War II was, mm-hmm. Because mm-hmm. most of what happened in World War II is a result of World War I, and some aspects of our modern world that are so important, such as the Middle East, are directly a result.
Yeah, I agree with you. You can read in Margaret Macmillan's book, 1919, about the people who drew the map of the Middle East were down on their hands and knees with a map the size of the floor, trying to figure out where to draw lines just arbitrarily in a room in Paris.
Yeah, and of course the problem with that is the geographical boundaries don't match the ethnic boundaries, the religious boundaries, the aspirational boundaries. Think of the Jewish people looking for a homeland. The same problem, the British had the same problem at the end of the Second World War with India, is the boundaries, they put too much faith in geography and not enough understanding of people's emotions and sentiment.
And too much horse trading back and forth.
And power politics always enters in, of course.
Right. According to The Independent, which is a UK publication, more than 1,000 books have been or will be published between October 2013 and October 2014 pertaining in one way or another to World War I. Add to those the many thousands already in print, and it's clear that World War I is a significant part of world literature. Crosby, could you tell us why the library and the museum chose these two books in particular for the Great War, Great Read program?
Well, I think there are a couple of reasons. And reason number one would be the literary quality of both these books. They're both great writers. I mean, All Quiet on the Western Front, I had someone was watching me. I was reading this on the Cape. I took a little vacation on Cape Cod. And there was a guy coming out of a restaurant where I was sitting reading this. And he looked at it and he said, that was the best book that they made me read in college. and he said it's the only book I finished that they told me to read in college. And it's a literary masterpiece. If you get I guess this is the Ballantine edition, it says the greatest war novel of all time. You know, Stephen Crane might object, there's, you know, Tolstoy might object, but it is a great book, and it has a high literary quality, and like The Guns of August, Barbara Tuchman's book, it has a tremendous quality of both realism and irony combined with a very strong imagination. Many critics have noticed in Barbara Tuchman's book, the beginning of the book, which is a description of Edward VII's funeral, and all the monarchs of the world, the leaders of the world, come together, and her description of this is really fantastic. Many historians have said that the first book they read that turned them on to history was the great narrative quality of Barbara Tuchman's The Guns of August. And in All Quiet on the Western Front, there are places that the imagination is extraordinary. He has a scene where there's a bombardment of Paul Bomber, the protagonist's company is engaged, and it's in a cemetery, and bodies are flying, and it's hard to tell whether they're live bodies or dead bodies, and they crawl into coffins to protect themselves, etc. And in what's probably the best book about literature of World War I, Paul Fussell's Great War and Modern Memory, he sort of objects to this. He says it's too gothic. I think it's not too gothic. I think it's extraordinary, and it captures your imagination about the nature of war. But there's another scene in the book where horses are being killed in a bombardment, and I won't spoil any of that for you. But it's a very realistic scene, but it has the same kind of gothic imaginative quality, but it's absolutely realistic. And similarly, Tuchman's book is obviously about it's a history. And she engages the characters, these fantastic characters, particularly the Kaiser. I mean, you can't come away and not understand the absolute how to put this. It is you're awestruck by how weird it is that tens of millions of people can be set in motion by people as strange as Wilhelm II, and that there weren't people around to say, you know, it was a democratic country in theory, they had a parliament. Somebody didn't say, wait a minute, but they didn't. And Tuchman captures that. So they're two extraordinary books.
Yeah, that have stood the test of time. They're both really called classics.
Yeah, they are absolutely classics, classic of history and a classic of war fiction.
Yeah. It's an oft-told tale, but I like the fact that John F. Kennedy read The Guns of August right when it came out and had a great effect on how he handled foreign affairs during his time as president.
Well, yeah, it said, I think, and Arthur Schlesinger said this in the Thousand Days, that it, the biggest influence on Kennedy's handling of the Cuban Missile Crisis was his reading of The Guns of August.
Yeah, and it also is one of those things that you have to go back and realize that it was a very groundbreaking work of history when it was published, that people weren't used to reading history that almost read like a novel, history that you could just turn the pages and keep going and see personalities and see what people were saying with each other, that it was very much a new kind of history when it came out.
Well, it's been said by a number of people in reading the book that we all know how it comes out. We all know what happens. And yet she engages you so much in the view of the characters of the leaders of the different countries that you're on the edge of your seat waiting to see what happens next, even though you already know what happens next.
Exactly. Is Britain going to actually commit? Are they?
Will they declare war? Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, it becomes you. She catches you up in the alternative history, the possibilities of the situation, so much that you're almost surprised. When the British, I mean, that's a great particular, when the British decide to declare war,
yeah.
It seems that they're backing away. The cabinet, majority of the cabinet is against it. And she describes that in such great detail that you assume that there's no way that Grey, who knows they have to go to war, and Churchill, of course, wants to go to war, that they finally win the day. You assume they can't possibly do it. The odds are against them.
Yeah. If you haven't read these books yet, you're going to want to read them, that's for sure. But we also want to talk about Kansas City's connection to the war, and I'd like to hear your thoughts on that.
You know, the night before the new museum, this place, opened, I got a chance, there was a dinner at the Kauffman Foundation, and I got to sit in between Sir John Keegan, the great military historian, the greatest military historian, some would say, who said about this place that it was second only to the Imperial War Museum as the greatest museum commemorating war, and then on my right was Ralph Applebaum, who is the designer of the museum. And I thought it was kind of interesting that after he'd already done it and was ready to open the next day, he turned to me at one point and he said, "Why is this in Kansas City?" I thought, well, you know, if you don't know now, but how am I going to? But I thought about it for a second, and there are the following reasons, it seems to me. The obvious reason is that Kansas City was a very significant mustering place. 600,000 people soldiers went through Union Station, which is more than went through any other transit location in the United States on their way to war. General Pershing, who led the American Expeditionary Force, was from Missouri. That's possibly another reason. There are probably some people in the civic leadership who knew Pershing, or knew people who knew Pershing. But the real reason, I think, is that civic leadership. The reason it's here and so extraordinary is that there were people like William Rockhill Nelson, R.A. Long, J.C. Nichols, and others who had a vision. And the vision is, which is really important for this place, for the memorial, it was that it shouldn't all have been in vain, that those deaths should be commemorated, and commemorated with knowledge and understanding of what went on and what it was supposed to be for. And I think they probably, by the time this actually got built, it was more about peace than it was about democracy, or even the idea that the United States was taking a global position. It was about, we must not ever do this again. Of course, we did it. We've done it again and again and again, and probably will continue to. I think it's the quality of civic entrepreneurship at that moment in Kansas City's history that had this place put here.
Yeah, I agree. In fact, I would say twice. First, to build the memorial, to build the Liberty Memorial, and then to build the museum where the memorial is. And that was a great act of civic leadership when the war ended, to say, let's raise the money and build the Liberty Memorial right across the street from Union Station, and then to follow up and build this beautiful museum. So Kansas City can be very proud of it. And we at the museum are trying our best to honor that heritage and to keep pointing out the enduring aspects of the First World War as it continues on today, as we've been talking about, as it goes on. Absolutely. And on and on. So these books are both worth your while, as are so many of the books that have been published. We have some contemporary authors coming who are publishing books right now, a book on Verdun, a book called Dark Invasion about 1915. We have a lot of authors coming in the next 3 months. There's a poster outside the auditorium that specifically lists the Great War, Great Read events that are going to be coming just in August. Both the library's website and the museum's website have a complete listing of all of the events, and there are more than 20 events planned for the next 3 months around the Great War, Great Read program. They're here, they're at the library, they're both places, are during the day, they're at the evening, they're on the weekend. So I would urge you to get engaged with this partnership that we've put together.
And the next event is D.M. John Greco, who is a great historian associated with the command school at Fort Leavenworth. We'll be talking about Harry Truman. One other obvious connection Kansas City has, it wasn't the reason for the memorial, but it's important in so many ways, both for us and for the world, is Harry Truman. And, you know, his life-changing experience was as a captain Battery D, and D.M. John Greco has written a very good book about Harry Truman in World War I, and he'll be talking about it at the library on Wednesday. So I highly recommend that. And I might mention one other connection that Kansas City has to, which is important, and an event that we'll be doing commemorating that. Ernest Hemingway got his start as a writer here. And it was at the time the war was already on, but it was the moment when we were going into the war in 1917 that he was working for the Star. He learned his craft at the Star. He said that years later. The Star's style manual, he said, was the best book on writing, which was on mimeograph sheets, was never published. And his beat was right here. He covered Union Station. And so it's also the 100th anniversary of Union Station, which, you know, it was completed in 1914. And one of the events we'll be doing, and I think we're going to do it at Union Station, is we'll be filming our next Meet the Past. And I will interview the young Ernest Hemingway. about his experiences in the war and his experiences at the Star and going through Union Station. There's a great moment at the beginning of one of his early short stories in which he says, Kansas City is very like Constantinople. I'll ask him about how he came to that conclusion.
That points to the variety of events for Great War, Great Union, which are not all the same. I want to mention before we go on that the library has a lot of copies of both books available to be checked out.
You can check these out.
And our museum store has copies for sale of both of those books, as well as the books of all the other coming authors that we've got. So you can stop by our museum shop to visit some. Those in the library has lots and lots of copies available. And we'll hope that you'll participate in all these. Now, one of the things that a great book does not always do is create a great film. Those two things, in fact, there are some great books that have led to terrible films. All Quiet on the Western Front is not one of those. It resulted in a film which won the Academy Award in 1930 for the Best Picture, and it's been an enduring classic that you're going to get to see here in just a few minutes. But Crosby, would you tell us just a little bit about the film?
And of course, there was a lot of controversy about this film historically. It was, of course, it came out just before Hitler took power. And when Hitler took power, one of the first things he did was to ban it because it's anti-war. It has an anti-war message and certainly doesn't portray the German officer class in the way that Hitler wanted it to be portrayed as he started to march around Europe. But it also had the distinction of being banned in a lot of other places. It was banned in Australia, for instance. Again, a little too anti-war in some ways for people who are still feeling pretty belligerent about one thing or another. But it had it's had a profound influence over the years. It's the American Film Institute's named it one of the 100 best movies. The Library of Congress has made it one of the films that they will preserve for all time. Steven Spielberg said that it was one of the biggest influences on his making of Saving Private Ryan. So it continues to have a major effect, a powerful movie.
It is. It's a really excellent movie, a great way for you to start, kick off this event. And again, we're really glad all of you are here. We welcome you. We hope that you'll be back to visit our museum many times and participate in our Great War, Great Read events. Thank you so much for coming.